Anybody want that banner?
Yeah, that's two, that's correct.
Can anybody sign? Just the tennis sheet going around?
So good.
Sheila, where's Sheila?
I'm here.
We can take that, and we'll just go back.
You can hold with that one if you want.
It's Sharon.
I want that one.
Everybody else must already sign.
Can hold on to that one and this one.
Okay.
Did I check that? I don't know if you heard.
We want Justin. Trump must go. Trump gotta go.
I signed your card.
Right here.
Oh, I thought Sharon signed the other one.
No, Sharon.
Okay. There's two going around. Can you pass it? Well, I'm gonna give it to these.
Yeah. I did.
Please feel free. I thought of you. Like after I got in the car, was on my way. I said, I'm going back. So if you need a ride back, I might need to leave right at the end because I have another thing I got to do. But if you're okay with that, I'll let you know. Okay.
Hi, this is front and back, okay? This is front and back.
Yeah, how was the trip to DC?
Let me see. Let me get over here. Hey, you made it. I thought you was on the cruise.
No.
Oh, next week. All right. Is that going to hurt your ear? No? All right. Power to the people.
Power to the people.
Power to the people. Long live Martin Luther King.
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 Long live the civil rights movement.
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 What do we want?
Justice.
When do we want it?
Now. What do we want?
Justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
What do we want?
Justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
No justice.
No peace.
No justice.
No peace.
No justice.
No peace.
If there ain't gonna be no justice,
there ain't gonna be no peace.
Martin Luther King, live like him. Dare to struggle.
Dare to win.
Martin Luther King.
Live like him.
Dare to struggle.
Dare to win.
Martin Luther King.
Live like him.
Dare to struggle.
Dare
to win. Martin Luther King.
Live like him.
Dare to struggle.
Dare to win.
Martin Luther King.
Live like him.
Dare to struggle.
Dare to win.
Rosa Parks. Live like her. Dare to struggle.
Dare to win.
Rosa Parks.
Live like her.
Dare to struggle.
Dare to win.
Bring that Rosa Parks man over here. Bring it over. This is also her holiday too. We're on this side here. There you go. Brothers and sisters, thank you all for coming out today. January 15th, the anniversary of the birthday of Dr. Martin Luther King. Had he been alive today, he would have been 88 years old. And it's amazing to think that he didn't even get to live half that long. The assassin's bullet cut him down on April the 4th, 1968. They thought by killing the man, they could kill the vision. But the vision and the legacy of Martin Luther King lives on. And it lives on through us who are here today. I'm glad to see all of you today. Glad to see every person who came out today to remember the life and legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King. The People's Organization for Progress, we have celebrated the birth date of Martin Luther King since our organization was founded in 1983. And so it is in that tradition that we're here today. But I think I'm reading your minds when I say that I believe that we feel that today's birthday celebration has extra special meaning. Because we've seen over this past year, particularly during this presidential campaign, not the reemergence, because it's always been here, but an intensification and a rise and increase in racist activity and racist violence here in the United States of America, but not just racist violence, all types of intolerance and hatred for which Dr. King would have been opposed. Dr. King not only opposed racism, but he opposed sexism.
That's right.
Dr. King not only opposed racism, but he opposed religious intolerance.
That's right.
He believed that all people should live together as brothers and sisters. And I believe that if Dr. King were alive today, he would be speaking out against the rampant Islamophobia and hatred that has been exhibited toward our Muslim brothers and sisters. Dr. King was one who believed that all people were members of the human family. And I believe if Dr. King were alive today, he would not tolerate the homophobia that we see in society today. We see with the intensification of racism and intensification of all forms of racism and intolerance. But Dr. King would not be sitting silently by while all this is happening. He would be on the front lines of struggle. And I think the best way we could celebrate his birthday today is to be out here marching in the street. And this must be the beginning. This must not be a one episode, a one serial episode. This has to be the beginning of a movement of resistance to Trump, to Trumpism. But believe me, brothers and sisters, Trump and Trumpism is just a manifestation of a deeper malady that exists in our society. And that is, our society is built on racism and exploitation and oppression. And what we see today are manifestations of that. But we are here today to celebrate the life, the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King. Dr. King was an extraordinary individual. Even as a child, he was outstanding. Graduated high school at age 15, finished undergraduate school at 19, was an ordained minister by 22, had his PhD by the time he was 26 years old. But we don't remember him for all of that, do we? We don't remember him for his degrees and what college he went to. We remember Martin Luther King because he was a freedom fighter, because he put his life on the line, giving ultimately the greatest sacrifice that one can give, and that's one's life. I see to my right here the Rosa Parks banner. Dr. King, his life was very short, 39 years. But even shorter was the time that he had, that he made an impact on the world. Consider this, Dr. King was asked to be the president of the Montgomery Improvement Association in 1955. December 5th is the beginning of the Montgomery bus boycott. And Dr. King is assassinated April 4th, 1968. That's just 13 years. 13 years was the duration of his leadership of the, just 13 years. And in that 13 years, he experienced brutal oppression. The night of the first rally for the Montgomery bus boycott, Dr. King's house was bombed with his wife and children in the house. His house was bombed several times. When he wrote his first book and was doing an autograph signing in Harlem, he was nearly stabbed to death by a woman, a deranged woman in Harlem. He was arrested 39 times. He was arrested so much, his children asked him, Daddy, why you go to jail so much? Right? This is true. Why you go to jail so much? Arrested 39 times. How many people in here have been arrested 39 times, besides for parking tickets? I'd have to raise my hand. But 39 times, acts of civil disobedience that led to his arrest. When he took the civil rights movement north, he was nearly stoned to death in Chicago, Illinois. Not in Selma, in Chicago. They tried to stone him to death in Chicago. And then, standing on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel, he was shot dead by an assassin's bullet. Dr. King didn't die of natural death. He didn't die of disease. He didn't die in his sleep. He died upon the orders of people in the United States government. And this is confirmed because Coretta Scott King went to court, filed suit against the federal government. And in that trial, which I believe took place in 1999, that federal judge ruled that Martin Luther King was the victim of a conspiracy in which at least 11 intelligence agencies were a part of. And as far as I'm concerned, I can't speak for you. I can only speak for myself. The case of the assassination of Martin Luther King is still an open case, and those who had anything to do with his death still need to be brought to justice. We can't let these things be swept under the rug. But we remember Martin Luther King because he was the titular leader of the civil rights movement, but we always have to keep that in mind. Dr. King wasn't the civil rights movement. He was one of the leaders of the civil rights movement. The masses of people made up the civil rights movement. Grassroots people, working people, poor people, people of conscience. That was the real army of the civil rights movement. And Dr. King happened to be the one that would be one of the major spokesmen for that movement. But we also remember Dr. King because his work was both a synthesis of theory and practice. Most of us think of Dr. King as just a great orator, but Dr. King was a prolific writer. He wrote 6 books: Measure of a Man, his autobiographical statement, Stride Toward Freedom, his story of the Montgomery bus boycott, Strength to Love, where he outlines the ideological and philosophical roots of his philosophy of nonviolence, Why We Can't Wait, that's where you can find the letter from a Birmingham jail. But more importantly, that book which he wrote after he received the Nobel Peace Prize outlined what Dr. King called what? His Bill of Rights for the Socially Disadvantaged. He wrote that in 64, and by 1968, he just said the Economic Bill of Rights, because Dr. King understood that the struggle was not just about legal rights. The struggle was also about economic justice.
That's right.
And that's where Dr. King was at the end of his life. Where was he at? He was in Memphis, Tennessee,
garbage
helping garbage. The sanitation workers try to form a local of AFSCME.
That's right.
Because the sanitation workers were abused and exploited more than any other group. They were being killed in the giant trash compactors. That's what sparked the strike. One of the workers had been killed in one of the compactors. And AFSCME called on Dr. King to come to Memphis. This was in 68. Said, Dr. King, please come and add your voice and your effort to help us get this union. And Dr. King's advisors didn't want him to go to Memphis because they were planning the Poor People's Campaign. They said, King, you don't have time to go to Memphis. You got to go to Washington for this Poor People's Campaign. He said, no, I got to help those struggling sanitation workers who were making then less than a dollar an hour. And Dr. King went to Memphis. And there's where he met the assassin's bullet. But I could end the story of his life right there. But most people don't know that a year after Dr. King was killed, his brother was killed. Did you know that? Dr. King's brother was killed. And then several years after that, what happens? A crazy person goes into the church where Dr. King's mother is playing the organ on a Sunday morning and kills his mother. I mean, how much more of a sacrifice can we expect someone to give? That they would not only lose their life, but lives of their family members would be taken. But brothers and sisters, we celebrate not just the life of Dr. King, but the legacy and the achievements of the civil rights movement. And the great achievement of the civil rights movement was the abolition of American legal apartheid. Because that don't call it apartheid in South Africa. The South Africans learned it from the Americans. There was no apartheid system in South Africa before the 20th century. They literally lifted the laws, the segregationist laws, from the books of the United States and transferred them to South Africa. The system of Bantu stands in South Africa is actually based on the system of Native American reservations here in the United States. Did you know that? Yes. So they gave it the name that obscures more than it revealed, call it Jim Crow, like it's something nice. You know, jump Jim Crow like it's a dance. It was a system of racial control and racial terror that black people lived under in this country. And I know because I'm old enough to remember it. And many in this crowd are old enough to remember it. How black people were killed and lynched with impunity. We protest against police brutality today. A lot of black people didn't even make it to jail. They would be put in a police car and taken somewhere else, like little Emmett Till, and beaten and mutilated and castrated. When they killed the civil rights workers, Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney, and they started dragging the rivers looking for their bodies, other bodies came up of people who had been lynched. From the end of the 19th century to about the middle of the 20th century, nearly 7,000 black people recorded lynchings of black people. Do you know, we joke today about stuff like reckless eyeballing, right? Reckless eyeballing was a law. It was a law. You remember a couple of months ago, somebody was killed down in South Carolina, and the police said what? Said, I went after him because he looked me in the eye. Because in the South, legally, at one time, legally, it was the law that a black person couldn't look a white person in the eye. If white people come down the street, you had to step off the sidewalk. I mean, this is just the little stuff. It was a system of racial control and racial terror. And if you were thought to be a civil rights worker or someone who would speak out about the oppression and about the racism and discrimination, you get a visit from the Ku Klux Klan. And we got somebody that's going to speak today who had a cross burned on her lawn in Enfield, North Carolina. But this segregation that Dr. King was protesting against, brothers and sisters, wasn't just in the South. People think that this was a Southern phenomenon, like they think slavery was over in the South. Slavery was an American institution. There was slavery here in New Jersey. New Jersey was the last Northern state to abolish slavery. New Jersey wasn't even in the 27 state majority to ratify the 13th Amendment. There was a lot of sympathy in Jersey for the South. Lincoln didn't win Jersey in 1860, he didn't win it in 1864. When Lincoln issues the Emancipation Proclamation, the New Jersey state legislature nullifies Lincoln's power to emancipate slaves in this state. That church down there, the old First Presbyterian Church, was a station on the Underground Railroad. You can go into the tunnels under that church. The church right off of Branford Place on Broad Street was an Underground Railroad station. And they told those runaways, they said, don't stop here in Jersey. Keep going. You might be like 12 years a slave. They might send you back. But segregation was here. Right here in Newark, in my lifetime. There were segregated movie theaters. The Paramount, the RKO Proctors, the Lowy's, the Branford, the Adams. Black people couldn't sit in the mezzanine, in the main part downstairs. We had to sit in the balcony. You see that big brown building over there? That used to be the Bamberger's building. Black people could not try on clothes in that building. It's not even like the building is gone, right? I got to tell you about something that don't exist. That's the building that used to be Bamberger's department store in Newark. Black people could not try on clothes in Bamberger's. And most of these corporations that were down here at that time, like the National Newark and Essex Bank, the Howard Savings, who remember Howard Savings? The Howard Savings Bank. Black people couldn't even get no jobs there. They couldn't even get jobs. You could be a cleaning person or a janitor. That's it. There were no black tellers. The first civil rights demonstration in the contemporary period that happens in Newark is where? At the White Castle. The same White Castle is over there on Hawthorne and Avenue and Elizabeth. Black people could buy a hamburger there, but you couldn't work there. So they had a chapter in Newark of the Congress of Racial Equality called CORE. And in 1957, they had a demonstration at the White Castle. Jim Crow was right here. We had segregated beaches. We had segregated swimming pools. I'm talking about up here. I ain't even talking about Montgomery. I'm talking about Olympic Park, when at one time, black people could only come on certain nights. Negroes could not come any day of the week. Negroes could only come on certain nights. And this goes to Dr. King in one of his speeches. He's telling his little daughter. His little daughter asked him, "Daddy, why can't I go to Funtown?" Funtown was like this little amusement park, right? "Daddy, why can't we go to Funtown?" Because black kids weren't allowed to come to the amusement park. I lived up on 12th Street. We didn't even have a swimming pool in our area. We had to go to Valesburg to the Boylan Street Pool. How many know Boylan Street Pool I'm talking about? You'll never believe this, but there was a time when they would chase us out from Boylan Street Pool. They would chase us from Boylan Street all the way down to the parkway. I know, because I was one of the ones that was chased. Segregation was here, brothers and sisters. In fact, it's still here. The great accomplishment of the civil rights movement was the abolition of legal de jure apartheid segregation. But de facto, apartheid still exists. In fact, New Jersey is one of the most racially segregated states in the nation. It's more segregated here than some of them states down south. The New Jersey public schools are the fifth most segregated state public school system in the nation. Somebody, am I right or wrong?
Right.
I'm right. Housing segregation. We're one of the most segregated states in the top 10. In the United States of America. So the great accomplishment of the civil rights movement was the abolition of legal apartheid, but the work that we have to do today is the abolition of de facto apartheid that still exists in this country. And we see this, we see the manifestation of this even in this last presidential election. How is that? Well, here's how it is. Donald Trump did not win the popular vote. He didn't win the election. He didn't even win it close. Hillary Clinton, I mean, we could have a whole discussion how it happened, but let's just talk about the numbers. Hillary Clinton got 3 million more votes than Donald Trump. Now, how is it that we're taught in school from the time we elect the homeroom representative to the time we're old enough to vote to the time we elect governors and senators and congresspeople that it's majority rule, but when we get to the president, 170 million people can vote, but only 538 people actually make the decision, and they talk about totalitarianism somewhere else, right? They talk about totalitarianism somewhere else. I mean, many of us had never really given this serious thought. We always thought we elected the president. But it's an electoral college that elected the president. And the electoral college is, in fact, a vestige of the system of racial enslavement here in this country. How is this? It is because the southern states, the southern slave-holding, newly formed states, wanted to have a greater voice because they felt they were outnumbered. Why was that? Because the white populations in the northern states were larger than the white populations in the southern states. So what did they do? They passed that amendment. The three-fifths. Now, a lot of people say colloquially, oh, that means that three-fifths of the people. No, that's not what it means. What it means is that the slave-holding states were allowed to count three-fifths of their enslaved people toward the total population so that state could increase its representation in the Congress. And this Electoral College was another way, because the number of the Electoral College equals the combined number of the people in the House of Representatives and in the U.S. Senate. And so this outcome in November 8th of 2016 is in fact a historical outcome. And brothers and sisters, we will come back to this place again. As long as the Electoral College exists, we need to abolish the Electoral College and have direct election of the President of the United States, just like we elect every other officer in here in the United States. So we stand here today to recognize the great achievement, the Civil Rights Act, which abolished this legal apartheid. I can remember when we used to go on bus rides. I'm speaking from experience now. We couldn't go. There were certain Howard Johnsons where we couldn't go and use the bathroom that everybody else used in the Howard Johnson. We had to go round the back and use a bathroom if they had one. If they had one. When I was a little boy, they used to send me south every summer because I was bad. So they sent me down to the farm to run it off. We got on the train in Newark Penn Station. That train still runs. It's called the Silver Meteor. When the Silver Meteor got to Washington, D.C., the conductor would come to us and tell us that we had to move toward rear cars of the train. Why was that? Because when you cross Washington, D.C., you cross the Mason-Dixon line. And when you cross the Mason-Dixon line, the segregated laws governing interstate travel came into effect. This was in my lifetime. This was something that I experienced. I'm speaking from experience. And many other people here can speak from experience. So Dr. King was the Civil Rights Movement was able to get the Civil Rights Act passed to do away with all these segregated accommodations that we had in the United States. And then Dr. King told LBJ, said, well, now we need a Voting Rights Act so that black people could vote. They would kill black people for voting. Imagine that. They would kill you if they knew you were going to the polls to vote. It wasn't just, they did teach us in little elementary school. They taught us about the poll tax and the grandfather clause and those things. But they didn't tell us about the racial terror. They didn't tell us about people who were killed for going to vote. This is in my lifetime. We're not talking about ancient history. I was in the sixth grade when the Voting Rights Act was passed in 1965. And the Voting Rights Act empowered people not only in the South but in the North. We had apartheid here in Newark. We had a predominantly black city, and we had an all-white municipal government. We had one black representative. We have a street up here in Newark called Irvin Turner Boulevard. Irvin Turner was the first black councilman elected in Newark and wasn't elected until 1960. But you know what? Even Irvin Turner, as early as 1963, called for the formation of a police review board in Newark because the police were part and parcel of the mechanism of the system of racial terror that exists in this country. Like when you see those demonstrations of the civil rights movement, most of the time you don't see the Klan. Who do you see? You see the local police and the state troopers whipping off. That's who beat up Congressman John Lewis. Bust his head wide open, was a state trooper. And then after the march on Selma, they ran down Jimmie Lee Jackson and they shot him to death in the community because he participated in that civil rights movement. So these were some of the accomplishments, but not only the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act, the Higher Education Act. Most of us have degrees today because of the Higher Education Act. There was no financial aid before 1966. There was no EOF. There was no such thing. There was only the GI Bill. And if you joined the Army and you were lucky enough to live, you could avail yourself of some benefits of the GI Bill, a low interest loan to get a house, and some money to go to school. It was the civil rights movement that demanded that these institutions, most of them, even Rutgers, which was a public school, they didn't accept a whole lot of black people. Princeton University, Paul Robeson was born in Princeton. They wouldn't accept Paul Robeson at Princeton University, which I went to. The Higher Education Act, which came after the Voting Rights Act, ferried through Congress by Adam Clayton Powell. Adam Clayton Powell Jr. created the financial aid program that doesn't just help black students, it helps all students that have economic need. See, people have to understand, the civil rights movement just didn't benefit black people. It benefited a whole lot of working and poor people of all races, brothers and sisters. This is very important to remember. Very important to remember. But at the end of his life, Dr. King was becoming more and more radical. He was being pushed in some ways to the left by people like Stokely Carmichael, who later became Kwame Ture. Many people talk about Dr. King's opposition to the war in Vietnam, but many people don't know that his wife, Coretta Scott King, came out against the war before he did. He was being pushed. Remember Congressman John Lewis, who's been in the news lately because, and I agree with him, Donald Trump is not a legitimate president. He's not my president. I agree with John Lewis on this. He is not our president. I don't always agree with John, but on this one, I got to agree with John. He is not legitimate. But it was in the news lately about John Lewis, and that Dr. King was becoming increasingly right. I raised John Lewis because John Lewis was a member of SNCC. SNCC came out against the war in Vietnam before 1963. And in fact, John Lewis was going to speak about the war in Vietnam at the March on Washington in 1963, but they told John Lewis, don't speak about Vietnam. They actually edited out that part of speech, and you can actually go and find the part of the speech that was edited out. Just Google. Right. Just Google John Lewis speech, 1963, March on Washington. And you'll see, because they didn't want to upset. You know, the same stuff that be going on today was going on then. political expediency. They said, y'all don't talk about the war in Vietnam because we're trying to get these Democrats and Dixiecrats to vote for the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act, so don't talk about Vietnam. So John didn't talk about Vietnam. But ultimately, Dr. King came out against the war in Vietnam. In fact, it's so ironic. Maybe it's more than ironic. His most famous speech on the war, he started coming out against the war publicly in 1966, but his most famous speech was A Time to Break the Silence. People know that speech popularly as Why I Opposed the War in Vietnam. But the name of the speech was A Time to Break the Silence because Dr. King said, we've been silent too long on Vietnam. And he came out against the war in Vietnam, gave that speech at the Riverside Church in New York City on April 4th, 1967. He was assassinated on April 4th, 1968. But it wasn't just because of the war that they assassinated Dr. King. They assassinated Dr. King because he was becoming increasingly critical of our economic system. The very first speech I ever heard by Dr. King wasn't the I Have a Dream speech. It was a speech he gave after he received the Nobel Peace Prize. And I heard Dr. King say the words, our system of monopolistic capitalism. Because he was talking about overproduction. They didn't know what all to do with all this corn and wheat they had. Dr. King said, I know what to do with the corn and the wheat. Put it in the bellies of the children that go to bed hungry at night in the United States of America. That's what Dr. King said. You read that book, Where Do We Go From Here, Chaos or Community? Dr. King says, we need a radical redistribution of power and wealth in our society. That's a quote. Quote, we need a radical restructuring of our socioeconomic system. This is why they killed Dr. King. Not just because he said those things, but because he had the ability to unite a broad enough critical mass of people that could have actually brought this about. And this is the task that faces us today. This is the work that Dr. King left us. We must put that coalition of peoples together. Look, we all have our group struggles. Black people struggling against racism, women struggling against sexism, workers struggling against attacks on labor rights, and on and on and on. Yes, we have our particular struggles, but we got to find a way to knit all of these different struggles together into one great movement that can transform this society, brothers and sisters. That's the task that and we've been like a helicopter hovering in place for the last 50 years because we've actually gone backwards. Our demands that we are making today are less radical than the demands that Dr. King was making in 1968. Do you know in 1968, Dr. King was calling for not just charity for the poor, he was calling for the elimination of poverty. And how was he going to do that? Dr. King, in his Economic Bill of Rights, called for a guaranteed minimum income for all Americans in 1968. And we stepped back from that. We stepped way back. Now we're trying to catch back up to it with $15 an hour and jobs and a living wage. If you work 40 hours a week, you should have enough money to support your family, pay your bills, have a decent quality of life. This is the richest country in the world. There's no reason why any student that has the desire to go to college shouldn't be able to go to college. If they got free college in Europe, we should have free college right here in the United States of America for all of our people. As early as 1968, the demand for universal health care is not a demand. Do you know that people have been making that demand since the administration of Teddy Roosevelt at the beginning of the 20th century? It's an old demand. Because what is the whole purpose of society if in fact we don't make life easier and better for people? What is the purpose of all this technology and all these advances if in fact people's lives are degraded and harder and harder and harder? The point of society is to organize production and organize life in such a way so that every human being can live to their fullest potential and have a high quality of life. There's no reason why we should have hungry children in the richest country in the world. There's no reason why we should go down there to Penn Station and find people sleeping under the overpass at Penn Station. No reason. What the only reason that these things exist is because the current balance of power is in favor of those who own and control this society. This is why we have to work. We have to organize. We have to unite. We have to mobilize to change the balance of power. The people that run and own this society are 1%. The rest of us are 99%. There's no reason why the 99% can't take it over from the 1%. So, brothers and sisters, I'm not saying anything new here. All that I've said, Dr. King had already said. And if you just read his work, and I challenge those of you today who are here. You know, when we come together like this, we talk about changing the world and changing the country. I'm going to ask you to do one little thing. We got a national monument to Martin Luther King. We got a national holiday to Martin Luther King. But I dare anybody to come up here to this mic and tell me that Dr. King's writings are required reading in any high school or middle school in the state of New Jersey. I don't understand how we can have a national monument, a national holiday, and the children don't know any more about Dr. King than I have a dream, including some of you. If we're going to have a national holiday and a national monument, his writings should be required readings at least in our secondary schools and in our colleges. So I challenge you to go back to the schools in your community, to have a meeting with the principal and the superintendent in your community and say, what can we do to make this happen? Because there was a law passed in New Jersey called the Amistad Act. And the Amistad Act requires that black studies be taught in all courses, not just in black courses, in all areas of academic endeavor. There should be the contributions that black people have made. That's a law in New Jersey. Most people don't know that. And the man that passed that law is right there. Former Assemblyman Bill Payne. Give him a big hand. He's the one that passed that law. So, today, brothers and sisters, we're going to march. We're going to march in the tradition of Dr. Martin Luther King, but not only of Dr. King, in the tradition of all those who gave their lives. Many people don't know that hundreds of people died in the Civil Rights Movement. It wasn't just Dr. King. There were hundreds that died. And there were great leaders, and the leaders weren't only men. There were as many great women leaders in the Civil Rights Movement as there were men leaders. In fact, one of those great people, Fannie Lou Hamer, was right here in New Jersey. When Fannie Lou Hamer protested, it was right on the boardwalk here of Atlantic City when the Democratic Convention was being held. So we have all kind of connections in New Jersey to the Civil Rights Movement. But right now, we're going to march in a few minutes. But before we march, we're going to hear from a few people. I want to bring together, I told y'all about how people were terrorized by the Klan. I'm going to bring a lady, a living witness of Klan terror to you right now. Her name is Willa Cofield. Where's Willa? Willa Cofield. Where is she? Where's Willa Cofield? Willa, give her a hand. This is Willa Cofield. Give her a big hand. Willa Cofield. Tell the people what you experienced.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for being here. I want to say that it's an honor and privilege for me to come to share in this celebration of Martin Luther King's birthday. I always keep up with Martin Luther King's age because I happen to be 3 months older than he.
Wow.
So I know that I was born in October 1928. He was born January 15th, 1929. I also had another slight association. He crossed my path, I am sure. In 1951, he was studying at the University of Pennsylvania. There were about six Negroes, they were called at that time, black people, on the campus of the University of Pennsylvania. And he was studying in one of the buildings called Bennett Hall for one summer. And I was there, I was a student there that summer. I don't remember seeing him, and I never knew that he was there when I was there, but I read it in the paper that the students at the University of Pennsylvania published. The second time I actually saw him, I was in his presence at a White House conference in 1965. They called a conference in Washington and invited civil rights leaders from all over the South to come to Washington. Now, they don't have the White House conference in the White House. I've never been to the White House. They actually have the conference in hotels. And this conference was in the Mayflower Hotel in Washington, D.C. And there were civil rights leaders from all over the South. Martin Luther King was the centerpiece. Wherever you saw him, there were not quite as many people as are here, but there were dozens of people surrounding him. You couldn't get close to him. When you did see him, he looked as if he had just put on a beautiful suit, and he was just glowing. He wore these light-colored suits, and he looked great. One morning, I think it was the second morning of the conference, I was standing in the lobby of the Mayflower Hotel, and he walked in. And there were only a couple of people with him. And I had every opportunity to go over and speak to him, which I did not take the opportunity to do. I think I had been talking to too many SNCC people who called him DeLord, and I just sort of watched him. But I've always regretted that. But I wanted to tell you briefly about a part of his work that is rarely discussed. And I did participate in that part of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference program. Martin Luther King had what was called citizenship schools. They organized citizenship schools all over the South. The schools were led by a woman named Septima Clark.
Yes.
Septima Clark had organized black teachers in Charleston, South Carolina in the 1920s. She worked there for 40 years, and she belonged to the NAACP, and they fired her. She wouldn't give up her membership. So she went to the Highlander School in Tennessee, and she carried with her a curriculum that she and Esau Jenkins and Bernice Robinson had developed in the South Sea Islands off the coast of South Carolina. This was a literacy program, a way of teaching people about citizenship and how to vote and how to be a good citizen. The Highlander School adopted this curriculum, and Martin Luther King and the American Missionary Association took the program over, and they started implementing it all over the South. Dorothy Cotton said she was the leader of the citizenship schools from 1962 to 1967. She said wherever you saw an intense protest across whatever community you saw, the leaders had been educated, had been trained in the citizenship school. Now, I had a chance to go and be trained in the citizenship school. On the same weekend that Goodman, Cheney, and Schwerner were missing, I took 15 students to Dorchester, Georgia, to be trained at Martin Luther King School. And it was a wonderful week when we saw where we had to sleep, when we saw what we had to eat, we almost felt like going back home. But there was so much spirit, there was so much enthusiasm, we soon forgot the crude quarters that we had to stay in. Everywhere, there were people there from Mississippi, Georgia, Alabama, people who had fought the Klan up and down the streets, in the churches, at their homes, and they were there to tell their story. Everybody was just so up. And the thing I remember most was the singing. Everywhere we went, there were freedom songs. If you look for me on the back of the bus and you don't see me nowhere, come on up to the front of the bus and I'll be riding up there. So, everywhere, the songs just broke out on the porch, in the dining room, in the classrooms, all over the place. My students did not want to go home. They were crying when we left that place. And we went back to Halifax County, North Carolina. I started my literacy class because the idea was that you brought these people in and you taught them how to read and how to write, and you used political terms because they had taught us new words. Like, I had never heard about power structure before, but we learned habeas corpus. I didn't know of those things, but I was able to share it with people in my community. And we had a graduation ceremony, and these old people, some of them were almost as old as I am now, got certificates signed by Martin Luther King. So the citizenship program was kind of like what happens at Pop, where Larry teaches us black history and tells us about political things, demystifies government. You see how much he knows about Martin Luther King. He's the best teacher I think I've sat under. He is an excellent teacher. So Pop is performing the work of the citizenship schools, and they were vital to the success of Martin Luther King. So I invite all of you to come to our meetings on Thursday night at Abyssinia Baptist Church. Am I telling it right?
Tell them about the Klan. Tell them about the Klan. Tell them about the Klan. Tell them about
the Klan. Well, I was a teacher in a little town in North Carolina. I'd been there for 12 years. And my husband decided to run for the town council. No, as far as we knew, no black person had ever, am I standing in the
church?
No black person had ever held a political office in that town. Now, that's what we were told. About 20 years later, we found out that a black congressman had actually lived in our town. But by the time I grew up, everybody had forgotten that. But at any rate, people were very upset. You know, they put a big article in the newspaper and everybody was whispering and talking about it. And so, one night, a neighbor called and said, "Look out there in your backyard." And we all ran to the window and the whole black backyard was lit up. And there was this cross that had been burned on our lawn. Well, it had the opposite effect of frightening everybody, because it made everybody mad. And we started taking carloads of people down to be registered to vote. And it was a wonderful, wonderful turnout of our community. Well, this just started it. My students started asking, why can't we sit downstairs in the theater? Why do we have to go upstairs in that little place they have upstairs. So one night, two of my students went down and asked the manager, can't you do, can't we buy tickets and just sit downstairs? Because you had to buy your ticket, go outside, some outside steps, and go upstairs to this balcony. So the manager told them, I do this as a community service. If you don't like it, you just don't come. So the students came home, and the next day they were supposed to graduate from high school. But instead, we called Floyd McKissick, and he said, put a picket line in front of that theater. And that's what we did. And we picketed until it closed. And they wouldn't integrate it, but they closed it down. Well, that went on and on for the whole summer. After the March on Washington, we had a big fight in the streets of Enfield with the police. And they brought out the fire trucks and washed people off the sidewalks. All the people in the movement were in jail, and the whole community was out. Well, as a result of all of this activity, my job, I'd been teaching at the high school for 12 years, suddenly I became not a good teacher. They told me I was insubordinate to the principal, and they fired me. And the day that we went into court, and we had really good civil rights attorneys, we went into court 30 days after the day they had told me I didn't have a job. The day that the suit was filed, a 17-foot cross was burned in front of my house.
17-foot cross?
It was 17 feet tall. And it was terrible. But the fight went on in court. I got a lot of help from people all over the country. And in 3 years' time, my job was restored. And it is said, the NEA says, that that suit saved the jobs of 40,000 teachers throughout the South. Because school boards knew that black teachers were in those classrooms sending those children out into the streets, and they were getting ready to fire them wholesale. So that is something that has changed my life, has moved me from North Carolina to New Jersey, but I am still with the people. I am still struggling. And I hope that is going to always be the case.
Power to the people.
So, power to the people. Thank
power
you.
To the people.
Give a big hand, Willa Cofield. Give you some eyewitness history of the civil rights movement. We're gonna march. Now, we got a lot of speakers, but I'm gonna have to enforce some discipline here. Everybody is gonna speak. When we get back, I want to recognize Assemblyman Bill Payne, the author of the Amistad Act. I see the City Council President Mildred Crump is here. I see the man that delivered my oldest daughter, Laini, Dr. Ewan McGarrett, the first black board member on the Newark School Board in the history. He's still alive. There he is, the first black board member of the Board of Education in the city of Newark. We are going to hear from one more person, and that's only because he's on the campaign trail. He's got other stops to make, but he was there's no secret. Y'all know that I was a Bernie Sanders supporter, and I was a delegate. I was a delegate for Bernie Sanders to the Democratic National Convention. And the other part of the story, we talked about Trump and Hillary, but they stole the nomination from Bernie Sanders, and that came out. And so you might say the outcome was the chickens coming home to roost, in a manner of speaking. But the chairman of the Bernie Sanders campaign in New Jersey is here, and I'm going to let him say a few words, then we're going to march downtown Newark. Assemblyman John Wisniewski. Give him a big hand.
Thank you very much, Larry.
So I have to tell you that I could stand here all day and listen to Larry Hamm. But we're here today because we want to remember the life and the legacy of Dr. King. And I'm standing next to this statue, and I'm wondering, what would he say today? What would he say today? Well, he probably would say, please don't build me a statue. He said, because he didn't want things of iron and steel and bricks and mortars. His whole thing was about changing people's minds, changing people's hearts. And would he be so profoundly disappointed at the direction we have gone as a society? Because when he started, he was making progress. And that progress today has seemed to be turned on its head. You know, he was the first person to talk about Black Lives Matter. Because at that point in time, as we just heard, there were so many people who thought they didn't matter. And so he started that, but he wasn't just about that one issue, because back then he was worried about people getting access to quality health care. Back then he was worried about people having enough food to eat. And it's sad to say that we come forward 50 years and we're no different today. And what's troubling is we live in a time where it seems that it's okay for our leaders to make sport of people who have nobody else to stand up for them, to demean people, to use rude and coarse language, to offend people. Leaders, he would not have stood for that. We don't stand for that.
Right.
And so what we need to do today, and every day, by the way, it's not just one day. It's good that we have a day that we stop and pause and reflect, but we shouldn't let it stop, because every day he fought the struggle. Every day we need to fight the struggle, because it's a battle that can be won. As Larry said so eloquently, there is 1%. There is 1% out there that controls so much. But we are the 99%.
That's right.
Let's make our voice heard. Let's make our voice heard so that young men and women can go to quality schools and get an education and lift themselves up. Let's make sure that we can make sure that young men and women, when they go to college, are not coming out crippled with student loan debt, that they can get a free state and university college education.
That's right.
Here in New Jersey.
That's right.
Let's make sure that men and women earn a living wage of $15 an hour.
That's right.
Women get paid an equal amount for equal work. There is so much work to be done. Let's go out and do that work.
Yeah,
Let's remember his legacy and keep in our hearts and minds that we still have so much work to do. Thank you all very much.
All right, brothers and sisters, we're going to march. We need to get the King banner that Munir has. The lead banner follows Aid out to the front. We got more banners here. Everybody come get a banner.
Power to the people. What do we want? When do we want it? What do we want? When do we want it? What do we want? When do we want it? No justice. No justice. No justice. If there ain't gonna be no justice.
All right, I think we're ready. Who's taking them out, Zaid? All right, we're ready.
What do we want? When do we want it? What do we want? When do we want it? What do we want? When do we want it? What do we want? When do we want it? No justice! No justice! No justice! No justice! If there ain't gonna be no justice!
No
justice! No justice!
No justice!
No justice!
No justice!
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
Zaid, hold up for a second. Where's Munir?
Right.
Munir's supposed to be in the front.
He's
not in the front. That's not the banner. Where's Munir back? The flag should be behind. The flag should be behind. You got to be, the front mean the front. The flag far behind. Thank you. What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
Keep the front banner clear so people can see it. What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
Martin Luther King! Yeah. Lord of struggle!
Yeah,
Martin Luther King!
Get right there!
Lord of struggle!
Yeah,
Martin Luther King!
Get right there!
Trump says get back, we say.
black hair.
Dead win.
Live black hair.
Dead win.
Live black hair.
Dead win.
Live like him.
Dead win.
Justice.
Association. So let's hear from some young people. Let's hear what they got to say. Who's going to speak for the MLK group, Seton Hall?
All right. Say you tell them your name and everything.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Leo Ricketts. I am a senior at Seton Hall University and a member of the Martin Luther King Scholarship. I'm proud to be here and I'm happy to see everybody that is around. This time, more than ever, young people, old people, black, white, everybody needs to come together because not just our rights are at attack, not just black people are at attack, not just people of color are at attack. Democracy is at attack.
Go ahead, son. Go ahead, son. That's right.
Our whole nation, the major systems of it are predicated on taking advantage of people and profit and consumption. That's what they're based in, and it is horrible at this point that our representatives and the people that are supposed to represent us in government are in cahoots with the same people that fight, that suppress our democracy, are cahoots with the same people that deprive us of our rights and our civil liberties, are the same people that continue systemic oppression in this country. So it is up to us to fight that. It's up to 99% to fight that. We are the exception to the rulers. We do not have to operate within a system that is predicated on making us sick, uneducating us, not advocating for us. It is not, that is not what we have to do. We can fight as people, we can organize as people, and together we can elect officials that do represent our interests. We don't have to accept what we've been given, and that's what we need to take home and take to our families and organize around. The fact that we don't need to accept Trump, We don't need to accept General Mattis. We don't need to accept the NSA directors. We don't have to accept Jeff Sessions. We don't have to accept tyranny. We don't have to accept anti-democratic institutions. We don't have to accept voter suppression. We don't have to accept poverty. We don't have to accept homelessness. We don't have to accept unsustainability. We have a choice. Young people have a choice. Old people have a choice. White people have a choice. Black people have a choice. Hispanic people have a choice. LGBT people have a choice. Disabled people have a choice. Everybody has an option to fight for their own democracy and be represented in a country that is not based on exploiting and consumption and capitalism and mass resources being given to the 1%. We do not have to accept that. Thank you.
Thank you. That's it.
All right. Let's hear from another young person. Anybody else from MLK? Go ahead. Introduce yourself.
Come on this side. Come on. Come on this side.
Hi, my name is Imani Miles. I attend Seattle University. I'm also, I'm a freshman. I'm a political science and Africana studies major. But, you know, we are going to a school at a predominantly, it's predominantly white institution, and it's very important that we have this organization because we are not being heard. We are the voices on this campus. We are representing, you know, our community. It's important that we realize that we're not powerless individuals, and we will not be complacent and comfortable in the way in which our society functions. It's time to make a difference. It's time to make a change. It's time to open your mouth and realize that it's not okay for our society to function this way. And we are giving, you know, students a voice because it's all about grassroots activism. It's all about changing society.
I say!
Right on. I heard that one of the children want to say something. You want to say something? Both of you? Okay, come on.
Come on up, baby. Stop
future. Come on this side. Come over here. Come around here.
They were already
okay.
In the front. I couldn't keep it back.
Come on. Okay. Fish.
Okay.
Nope. Okay.
Well,
we're not gonna say the same thing.
That's right.
Okay. Trump is not
I'll say.
I know Martin's been looking at you now. You gotta get it right.
Hey, you shadow
time. Come on.
Okay,
I'll say. Ladies and gentlemen. We need to save our community because Trump is not fit to be president. When he becomes president, he is going to turn this world into war. And also, Trump is not fit to be a president because he's going to make this a racism place.
That's right, baby. Thank you, little man. Go ahead, Prince. Let Prince say something.
And plus, Donald Trump was cheated.
That's right.
Get him a hand. Yeah. All right. Give the children a hand. I want to ask my vice chairwoman, Ingrid Hill, to come and say a few words. She's always organizing, but she never speaks. She going to speak today.
All right, Ashe, Ingrid.
Brothers and sisters, today it's a celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King, but more so is the celebration of his legacy. Understand that the U.S. government has declared war on its people. They're telling us what it is that they want us to do. The reality is that we have to fight back. We need, first and foremost, Trump is not our president.
That's right.
And we need to look and see how we can mobilize and move against him, because the reality is that there's not going to be any kind of peace on this planet, much less in the United States, if we don't get rid of Trump and his cronies. Okay, they're pushing back health care. They don't care about us, but they get their health care. Right. Trump, if you cheated on your taxes, if you cheated on anything, you'd be under the jail. We wouldn't even be able to locate it, and yet he still stands firm as the President of the United States. Therefore, we have an option. We can get our own power back. We need to organize. We need to mobilize. We cannot stop. Because I always think about Fannie Lou Hamer and all of the sisters and brothers who have fought in order for us to be where we are today, and our legacy is to continue that struggle. And some of us have to be prepared to die. Okay, because we're not going to get a revolution in this country unless we're willing to give up our lives. Okay, and we need to make sure that we work as an organized force together and that we have an agenda that's going to liberate all of us. Peace.
All right.
Yeah.
Ingrid said what Martin Luther King said. Martin Luther King said, if a man hasn't found something he's willing to die for, he's not fit to live. Now that's what Dr. King said himself. I'm going to ask Carol Gay to come up and say a few words on behalf of the labor movement here in New Jersey. She's the head of the New Jersey Industrial Union Council. Give her a hand, Carol Gay.
All right. Good afternoon, sisters, brothers, friends. Power to the people.
Power to the people.
When I say people, you say power. People.
Power.
People.
Power.
People.
Power.
People.
Power.
Yes, we know that's what it's going to take. People power. We are one human family. Right. We are one human community. And we are going to need each other more than ever. We need each other. We have got to stand together and stick together. The IUC, the Industrial Union Council, is proud to be here with you today to march on this Martin Luther King celebration of his life, his legacy. And we're all here to stand. We are here to stand with you against, or not, well, I should say not against, but we are here to stand with you always, always. For racial, economic, and social justice. We will always stand with you for racial, economic, and social justice. I'm holding this sign today, Medicare for All, because I just left New York earlier. We marched in a march for health care, for single-payer health care, down to the Bull at Wall Street. And you know that's, you know what the Bull at Wall Street stands for, greed and corruption. And all of us together, standing together, can fight that greed and corruption. But it's not just Wall Street and the 1%. We've all been talking about Trump and his cabinet, his nominees. I was down in Washington this week, and I got news for you. It's not just Trump and his nominees. The Democrats caved the first day. The Democrats caved on the first day. And so it is so important that all of us stand together, because we've got to be the ones to give them some backbone, to fight back, because it's going to take a whole lot of fighting back. And I know you all know Martin Luther King's, one of his famous quotes that all of us remember, of all forms of inequality, injustice in health care is the most shocking and the most inhumane. The most shocking and the most inhumane injustice in health care. So while they're trying to dismantle everything down in Washington, our health care, our Social Security, our Medicare, voting rights, civil rights, human rights, they are out to attack every right we have. So let's stand together, friends. Let's remember, healthcare is a human right. Healthcare is a human right. And we must not let them forget that. Thank you.
Thank you. Power to the people. Yes. Are there any Hispanic brothers and sisters out here who want to speak? Latino. Okay. Say a few words. Give them a hand. What's your name?
Introduce yourself. Hi, my name is Max. What's going on? I'm from the Party of Socialism Liberation. We're based in New York City, even though we're developing a branch in Jersey. If any of y'all want to talk to me, on my comrade Nick right here. We're both out here in Jersey trying to organize, trying to, you know, pick up young, motivated comrades who want to join and get out there. Now, first off, this march is for Martin Luther King. His legacy will always live on. I notice a lot of brown and black people, minorities, and we've got it the worst. Like, in 1968, Dr. King was fighting for equality, for equal rights, for, you know, to give us more, and today, look at today. We're still struggling. We're still fighting. And the system's actually turned back on us because the gains that we made in the 60s and 70s, they've just took them right back. And the capitalist agenda is more stronger than ever right now. I noticed they were talking about Trump earlier. My organization, the Party for Socialism and Liberation, are organizing buses to D.C. next Friday. We're going to be going out to D.C. to protest Trump's inauguration. If any of y'all are interested in getting on a bus and going to D.C. and protesting, it's next Friday. We're going to be, first off, just get at me after, because I got to give you information of where to get the tickets. But it's going to be, we're going to be meeting up at 1 a.m. in East Harlem or at Union Square. We have a couple locations that are going out to D.C. and we have buses heading out to those locations. And of course, you got to get tickets. You get on the bus. We're going to head out there just for the day. Come back the next night. If y'all want to come, just see me or Nick afterwards. Also, he mentioned Hispanic, so I want to speak a little bit about my patria, my country, Puerto Rico, because right now we're suffering. Right now we're suffering. Yeah, the same. Yeah, the Oscar López Rivera and the many political prisoners, the many Boricua have suffered and languished in the prisons of the United States only for fighting for their sovereignty, for their independence, only to break free of the chains of colonialism and capitalism. And we're still suffering from that today. Just last year, my aunt, my titi, she passed away because of substandard health care in my island. Like, and a lot of people say, oh, Puerto Rico, they good, they are part of the United States, why would you want independence? But that's all falsehoods, because economically we suffer. We have over a 30% unemployment rate. We have people in the streets doing drugs. We have a very high crime rate. Like, a lot of people think of Puerto Rico as paradise. It's not paradise. Why do you think we all came over here? Exactly. So, and there's been a lot of brainwashing. There's been a lot of indoctrination. They put us in the housing projects, and look, 50 years later, we're still in the housing projects. We haven't made any progress. Borigua, you already know, mama. Yeah, so anyway, if any of y'all want to talk, we could build our Jersey branch. We're trying to build with the People's Organization for Progress, for one. The CWA is here. I know if any of y'all want to speak to me and my comrade, we want to build, we want to reach out, because united we can't be defeated. If we're all separate, if we're all here fighting one struggle, they can take us down like nothing. But if we're united, if we're like structured, if we're strong, that's how we're gonna defeat capitalism. That's how we're gonna defeat oppression, repression, and, you know, give rights to everybody. Anyway, thank you everybody for listening. All of y'all have a nice day.
We had the Filipino brothers and sisters here. Uncle Bayan? Yes. Bayan? Anybody? Did they leave? You want to say something? While they're coming, I'm going to ask Ted Glick. One of the big issues we're going to have to deal with Trump is the environment. And he's appointing people to head up departments. And the people he's appointing, they are totally against the very mission of the departments they actually asked ahead. So Ted Glick has been fighting for a clean environment, against carbon pollution and environmental racism for a long time. Give him a hand, Ted Glick.
Thanks a lot, Larry. This is always an important day to me. I became an activist on the day that Martin Luther King was assassinated. I can name the day I started to become an activist, April 4th, 1968. I knew of him, had heard him speak a couple times, and when he was killed, that's what kicked me into motion, and I'm still going. The other thing I want to say before just mentioning what Larry said, this is actually the 14th day that I haven't eaten. I went 13 days through yesterday just consuming water. with some salt and potassium, and that's in connection with the fight to get Leonard Peltier out of prison. Leonard Peltier is a leader. Is a leader of the American Indian Movement. He's been unjustly imprisoned for 41 years. This is his chance. If Obama grants him executive clemency, just like others, Chelsea Manning, Oscar Lopez Rivera, Matula Shakur, right? There are a number of political prisoners who should be released. But I'm fasting to actually urge people to contact the White House. Call the White House, go and write into the White House off their website. This is when we could free some heroes of our movement who, when they get out, can still give leadership to our movement. So I would urge people to do that. I'll keep fasting. I'm now on liquids, fruit juice, and vegetable juice until the inauguration. Just real quick, in terms of what Larry said, Trump is a disaster for the climate and really for the planet as a whole in terms of all the ecosystems of the Earth. He's a disaster. Hillary Clinton wouldn't have been so bad. She wouldn't have been very good either. We would still need to be fighting and struggling and organizing if she'd been elected. But Trump really is a disaster for the environment. And it's really, and let's be, climate change, you know, it's the whole ecosystems of the Earth that are at danger, the coral reefs that are being killed. 70% of all of the sea ice up in the Arctic, the North Pole, is over 50 years, after millions of years of being up there, 70% of that has disappeared in the last 50 years. It's not just what you look at from above, it's what's underneath. And a lot of that ice that was very, very thick is now really, really thin. Those are just examples of what's happening to our Earth, primarily because of the burning of oil and coal and gas. And it's essential that we get off of those fossil fuels and onto wind energy and solar energy and the clean and renewable energy sources that are also good for the people, that don't pollute the air and the water for people who live, you know, around where they're fracking or where the refineries are refining the oil or where the coal plants are burning and putting all the pollution into the air. So they're good for the people. It's good for the people and good for the planet to get off these fossil fuels. There's also tremendous numbers of jobs. I saw just the other day on TV something like that there's 12 times as many jobs being created in the solar industry right now as is being created in the economy as a whole. It's a great source of jobs, positive jobs, future-oriented jobs. So this is something we also need to have as part of our agenda. The people that Trump has nominated as cabinet officials, Rex Tillerson, head of ExxonMobil, to be the Secretary of State. I mean, it's not a joke. It's an obscenity. It's an obscenity. And there's this guy Pruitt who's coming up this week for a hearing. As the head of the Environmental Protection Agency, he has fought consistently in alliance and collaboration with the oil and gas industry against the EPA, and he's the one Trump wants to put in. So, you know, we have a big fight on our hands on that issue, as on all of the other issues. And as everybody has said, we need to find ways to work together to strengthen our overall movement. Getting out like this, these actions, these demonstrations, nonviolent civil disobedience are critical right now. We got to stiffen the spine of some Democrats, people in the press. You know, we got to show them that people are rising up and we're not taking this and we're not backing down. Thanks a lot.
All right, the children here are shaking. They're freezing, so we're not going to be out here too much longer. We have our sisters here from Bayan that want to speak, to say a few words. These are Filipino sisters. Give them a hand.
Thanks so much, Larry, and thank you for having us here today. My name is Ana Robelo. I'm the Solidarity Officer of Anak Bayan, New Jersey. We're a Filipino youth and students mass organization that fights for the rights of Filipinos both here and abroad. And we stand here resolutely with the Black community in all of their forms of resistance, in remembering Martin Luther King's legacy today. And as many people have said, we really support intensifying the anti-imperialist struggle during Trump's presidency that's coming up this Friday. And especially right now in Anak Bayan, we're fighting for our right to education and encourage people to take back our education and to reinvest the money that's going into wars abroad and putting that back into social services that is really denied to all oppressed people here in the United States. And we invite people to also join us this Friday for our own people's inauguration in Jersey City with the Jersey City People's Alliance at Journal Square, going to City Hall to not only fight against Trump, but to call for the rights that we deserve as oppressed people and to claim a more legally binding sanctuary city status for Jersey City that should be happening everywhere to really protect immigrants and all of the oppressed people that Trump has been targeting throughout his campaign and that will only continue under his presidency. So thank you so much for having us here today, and we will continue in the struggle with POP and all oppressed people here in Newark. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Our New York branch, Carlos, you're going to give us a poem. We're going to start to wind it up here. Carlos, from our New York branch of People's Organization, give him a hand.
I say.
Bow to the people.
Bow to the people.
And I have to say this to, this is going on 50 years now when the late Dr. Martin Luther King spoke at Riverside Church in April 4th of 1967. I was a young person then. I'm still young now, but I'm just saying, I remember that. Well, of course, you always have to live good. But this is in memory of this, if the dead could speak. If the dead could speak like a page of history, a living space on this spring day of April the 4th of 1967, Dr. Martin Luther King shared his heart and soul within the circle of people at Riverside Church. For a moment, searching for joy, for all the joy of the heart, of saving the souls of the wounded, who only know pain, misery, death, and death. Watching the water being poisoned, thousands and thousands of children homeless. Today, we cannot ignore the war. Breaking the silence of our heart, we must be happy. The rhythms of the drum, the children of the Lord, this madness must cease. Late on April 17th at Central Park Shelter, he spoke as a citizen of hope for peace, justice, for all humans are a single body, and who tortures another one is wounding himself. Longing to remember the memories of my youth on April the 4th of 1968, as the wounds of the earth laid open, while the speeding of the beating drum, the warrior drum in Harlem, the voiceless were outraged. Lenox Avenue was a battlefront. King was murdered, oh yeah, like an old song of Mercy, Mercy, Mercy by Cannon Bird Early. We must be heard. We gathered in march in a language of peace down Fifth Avenue. Beside Central Park, the people were conscious, walking side by side. We marched for love, for justice, for peace, and no to war. We rallied like a circle of harmony in our heart. And today, we are darling to remember 50 years ago, honoring all members of the People's, Poor People's Campaign, and all the residents of Resurrection City. Darling to stand up for the voiceless and break our silence and guide our love. Power to the people.
Right, we're going to let Brother Bill Payne close us out. He's the author of the Amistad Act. He's a man like our own Amanifa Williams. Y'all have heard from Amanifa before, but Bill Payne met Dr. King, brought Dr. King to Newark and to Abyssinia, where we meet. Give him a big hand, Assemblyman Bill Payne.
Thank you, Mark. Thanks, everybody. I'm not going to keep you. It's just that I've been here in this fight for a long time. This cane here, I think, tells something. I told Larry a little earlier that I wasn't going to be able to march down and march back because I had shots in both of my knees the other day because they're starting to I didn't think they're not getting old, but I think they're starting to wear out a little bit, so I had some of that stuff put on my knees. But this was given to me, by the way, by the Kwanzaa last week, because I was voted in as Larry Ham has been as one of the elders of our community. So I joined the company with Larry Ham. Larry Ham is my hero. I've known him ever since he was a little guy, you know? And it's just so impressive. I don't care where he is, when it is, if he's going to have some kind of demonstration, I'm going to be there. Because it's my fight too. And he says to me something, thank you for coming. This is my fight. Don't thank me for coming to something that's mine. As a matter of fact, I'm angry because if it was election time, we'd have people out in the streets, those who are trying to run for office again, they'd be here. I always wonder, where are they afterwards? Where are they? We need them out here fighting as well, if in fact they're truthful about it. And we had to put some noise out behind those who are not here, because this fight belongs to everyone. I was out the other day down at the program where a choir sang, "We Shall Overcome." And I looked at the choir, and it was all black. There was a school that was integrated, and it was all black. And I said, this is a fight not just for us. As long as this becomes just a black fight, we're not going to solve it. I want everybody to know, this is their fight too. We shall overcome. They should be out there singing too. We're all impacted by this negative thing. I've been out there some time. As a matter of fact, I proudly wear this badge on here. It's from 1957. I was involved in a march, a prayer pilgrimage in Washington, D.C., before the March on Washington. I was there marching then because I was walking down the street, and Clarence Mitchell, who was the head of the NAACP in Washington, said, "Bill, come, join us too." And then in that march, it was Dr. King was there, a young man. Harry Belafonte was in it, and others were in it as well. And I walked and I marched then too. But the fight belongs to all of us. And the thing that annoys me so much is right now, for instance, John Lewis says he's not going to the inauguration. It's an illegal, it's just not right. This person who's been made president of the United States does not fit the mold. He's not qualified. Therefore, no one should go. It's an illegitimate inauguration. They should not be there. But you're saying, well, it's America. No. Until they do it right, we should not be there and honor that person. My God, he's demonstrated to all of us, everybody, that he's not equipped to be president of the United States of America or anything else. Someone with a filthy mind and things, the kinds he makes up. No, he does not belong to be president. And I don't think any one of the members of Congress should sit there and applaud that man. No, of course not. But anyway, that's the fire. It's a disgrace. You're right. I get off track. Dr. King, I love Dr. King. In fact, I met him the very first time. I met Dr. King in that march way back when. But also, when Dr. King came to, I brought him yesterday to Newark, because the junior leaguers were around. Mary Birch, Mrs. Birch, some of you may remember, called me and said, "Bill, you know Dr. King?" I said, "Yes." She said, "Call him and tell him I want him to come to Newark and speak to the leaguers." I said, "Mrs. Birch, Dr. King is all over the country, Bill. And if anybody knows Mrs. Birch, you have to know that when she said, do what you did it." And I said, "Yes, ma'am." And I called him, and he did come. Dr. King came and spoke at the Terrace Room and those days. And I was very pleased to be able to have that. At the same time, I had a long conversation with Dr. King about Malcolm X, and I'll share that with you one day also. But this belongs to, I feel I really have let you down, because on 1998, I introduced this legislation that all children, everybody should know about the history of African Americans, everybody, black and white. And I've been fighting it all these years, and we still haven't gotten it there. It's coming slowly. But these young people would know who our history, about our history. And they would hold their heads high as they are doing now. But I want all black and white people to know the contribution we made. And so I'm going to keep doing that, keep fighting it, and I'm going to keep supporting POP. But POP is made of people who are currently serving public office, and what they should be here. They asked us for their vote, but they don't come out here when we need them. They should be here. We should demand that they be here. They have to be here. But anyway, I'll conclude by just pointing out to you that I had this picture when we put this statue up. You know, I'm the Deputy Chief of Staff here in Essex County, and we talked about the statue, and we got to finally put it up here. And there was a picture out there, a picture that I'm proud of. It's the very first time I ever met Dr. Martin Luther King. It was in 1956 in San Francisco at an NAACP convention. And I was at that time the national chairman of the youth and college chapters of the NAACP, and I chaired a meeting that day, and Dr. King was the speaker. I won't keep it longer, but at that time, the Vietnam War was going on. And Dr. King said, "That's an unjust war, and we should not be involved in it." And other so-called leaders said, "Well, that's not our fight, Dr. King. We're just interested in the black things and whatnot. So we shouldn't get involved in that." That was some of the other leaders. Dr. King said, "This is unjust war, and we should not be in it." Anyway, at that time, I'll tell you that the leaders of the NAACP and others did not want this young man, 26 years old, to speak at the convention, said he won't speak here. We said he will, and we had all the other young people that were out there saying he will speak or there won't be a convention, and he spoke. He spoke here, okay? But in this picture, you'll see Bill Payne escorting him down after he made his speech. And also in this picture, you may have heard of Medgar Evers. Medgar Evers was also a friend of mine, and Medgar is in this picture too. And I had conversations with Medgar at that time. I said, Medgar, you can't go back to Mississippi because they said they're going to kill you. He said, Bill, have you ever been to Mississippi? I said, no, I haven't. He said, I'm going back to make it better for my children. And of course he went back, and of course he was killed. So that's why I can't stand people standing on the sidelines and won't do it because it's too cold or it's too this. These people, I knew people personally, gave their lives. That'll never stop. But my last time with Dr. King was over at Abyssinia Baptist Church. He came to speak there, and as he pulled up that night against the Vietnam War, I drove up and I, no place to park, I double parked my car. And as I ran across the street, a car pulled up and somebody said, Bill, wait for me. Turned around, it's Dr. King getting out of a car. And he said, you know, Bill, I'm so exhausted. He said, I've been in New Jersey all day long. I'm so tired. They want me to go to another church after we leave here, but I just can't do it. He said, when I leave here, I'm going to go to Harry's. Harry's going to have a fundraiser for my organization. Some of Harry Belafonte. He said, and maybe you'll come pick a ride over there with me. Well, anyway, he went in and made the speech, came out, and I had double parked, as I said. People were trying to get out. Dr. King came, got in the car, and he said, where's Bill? Bill, can't you come with us? I said, no, Dr. King, I have to move my car because I'm blocking people. So I'll see you next time. There was no next time. He waved goodbye. And that was the last time I ever saw him. Of course, I was at his funeral, but he gave his life. I mean, these people gave their lives. I can't understand it, why people just stand aside. I can't understand it. But anyway, thank you. Larry, you keep up fighting. I'm going to be there with you as long as I can. As Kane holds up.
Thank you all very much.
And we're going to have the Amistad legislation implemented so all children would know about the contributions that we have made to make this country.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. We got to have that in our own school.
Brothers and sisters, these children out here shaking. So I'm not. There are other people that need to speak, Zaid and Vice Chairman Adams and others, but I ask you, please, your indulgence. We will have other events and you can speak again at other times. These children here shaking, they up under me. I'm shaking. You know? I want to thank everybody for coming out. I want to thank especially Willa Cofield. Her testimony today was just amazing, you know. And next time we'll hear from Brother Amnifu again, who actually met Dr. King and Malcolm X. I didn't get to meet Martin Luther King. I did meet his wife, Coretta Scott King, when I was 17 years old, after I was appointed to the Newark Board of Education, the youngest school board member in the history of the country. I got a letter in the mail from Coretta Scott King saying that SCLC had selected me to receive their Youth Leadership Award in August of 1971, and they flew me down to New Orleans. And the first day I got there at the Roosevelt Hotel, I went into a room. I met Coretta Scott King, Ralph Abernathy, Andrew Young, Hosea Williams, and Rosa Parks. They were all together there in the hotel room. And that night, there was a big rally. It wasn't in the hotel. It was in the community, in the hood, like the real hood, on a baseball field in the park. But Mrs. King was there, and they had a big rally, and she gave me the award right there at that rally in the black community of New Orleans in 1971. I want to thank you all for coming out. This was a great rally, and we had black people, white people, there were Asian people here, Latino, Filipino. I'm a product of the Black Power movement, and I am an advocate of self-determination for black people. And I know that black people have to have unity to overcome the particular racial oppression that we experience in this country. But I also know that while we fight against the particular kind of oppression that we face, that we are not going to be able to solve that problem within the confines of the existing social system. We live in the belly of the beast. This is the epicenter of worldwide imperialism. This is the root of the source of suffering for all over the world. It's the strongest part of the system. And to overturn this system, it's going to take everybody who wants to fight. It is ultimately, and I say this at the risk of being criticized by others, ultimately it is going to take a multiracial coalition, a multiracial movement to in fact confront this system and overturn it. It's a hard thing to come to, especially those of us like myself that come out of the black community raised up by black nationalists. I am still a black nationalist. I'm still a Pan-Africanist. But I'm also an internationalist. And I understand that ultimately we're going to have to build a multiracial, multinational movement to confront this system. This is the most powerful system in the world. That's why it's taken so long to change it. That's why it took 200 years to bring down slavery. That's why it took another 100 years to bring down Jim Crow segregation. So I thank you all for coming out today. You really made me happy today.
We thank you.
Because I was wondering what kind of turnout we were going to have. But we had a good turnout. And it looked good going down Market Street today. And coming back up. We did honor to Martin Luther King today. Power to the people. Power to the people.
Power to the people.
Power to the people. Long live Martin Luther King. Long live Martin Luther King.
Long live Martin Luther King.
Go in peace, brothers and sisters. Thank you very much.